is fascism. Since the beginning of the recorded history, we humans are crippled with three fundamental disabilities. When it comes to showing up for political disasters, we tend to act like rock stars. That is to say, fashionably late, a punctuality problem that has often proven deadly. Rather than hear the footsteps of a disaster due to an unfortunate wiring problem in our brains, we either mute the news or choke the messenger just to keep peace of mind. And when the political disaster happens, we tend to think that somebody should do something, and it only occurs to us too late that somebody should have been us. Why do I say this? Let me tell you my story so it makes sense. I'm from Turkey, and I've been following politics and writing about it since I'm 19. I am 50 now. That's a lot of time. As you might already know, Turkey is not an easy place to live, especially for those who are against the oppressive regime. And as a critic of the regime, I had to leave my country. That was 2016. When I left Turkey, I had finally some headspace to think what really happened to my country, Turkey. But then 2016 was a very interesting year as well. Trump came to power, Brexit happened, far-right politicians started popping up in Europe and United States. But then many thought that it will be back to normal if we get rid of these crazy politicians. And many believed that this crisis of democracy would be kept within the borders of crazy countries such as Turkey, India, or Italy. Many were puzzled. It didn't make sense. Why would people turn away from democracy to choose authoritarian leaders? Confusion was the overriding state of mind. So I looked into this confusion and turmoil and noticed something. There were, in fact, seven global common patterns in how authoritarian leaders came to power and take over democracies. What seemed like an insane circus of politics had actually a logic, an inner logic. It was like a machine, almost, that worked exactly the same way in each country. So it was very clear that crisis of democracy was a global phenomenon, and it was here to stay. So I wrote a book called How to Lose a Country, and I looked at the seven global common patterns of losing democracy. I won't bore you with a long political lecture, and it would be really difficult with the consecutive translation anyway, but I want to go through the seven global patterns, seven steps to lose a country very quickly. What these leaders, when they come to power or to come to power, they proclaim that the political establishment is dead, party is over, so they create a movement. And the second step is they disrupt the rationale and terrorize the language. They do not do this to prove a point or to present a political program. They want to dishevel the entire political realm. Third step, they remove the shame from politics and legitimize immorality. Their job is not very difficult because we are living in a post-truth world where it's not easy to separate the truth from lie. The fourth step is when they're in power, they dismantle judicial and political mechanisms. And when enough time passes, they begin to design their ideal citizen. And if you're not one of them, you become the enemy of the people. And sixth step, they let us laugh at them. we think that, oh, they wouldn't do that, and they take advantage of our laid-back thinking. And the last step is they build their country, and you begin to think that, I cannot recognize my people. This is not my country anymore. Okay, the loss of democracy in the first phase happens by these leaders or political movements claiming that political establishment is dead, party's over, everybody else, all the other politicians are fake, and they are the voice of the real people. To be honest, they are not totally wrong. Party's over. The coupling of liberal democracy with unleashed capitalism is long dead. The promise of democracy, dignity, and equality for all has been cancelled out by the brutality of capitalism. Let's be clear here. We know that we need a profound movement, not only to protect democracy, establish dignity and equality, but also to prevent the planet from its final destruction. But today, it's only far right who taps into this gathering anger and the need for change. Why is that? In order to answer that question, we have to go back to the 1980s when this system was established. It was then that we were promised if democracy is coupled with enough market economy, enough capitalism, it would thrive. With violence there, propaganda here, we were made to believe this was the natural order of things. We were made to believe this was the end of ideology and this would be great for all of us. We have been living in this system for quite a long time now, and it has been so long that we have forgotten this is only one way of living. There can be other ways too. And it was this system, actually, that produced Trump and leaders like him. So, actually, Trump and leaders like him are not deviations of the system, but they are actually the system. They are only the extreme examples of what is favored by the system. And that is exactly why our current institutions, political or judicial, cannot suffice to protect us from fascism. Right-wing leaders are in global solidarity, so we have to be in global solidarity to create a counter-movement to establish real democracy with real dignity and real equality for all. If we do not do that, it is going to be global fascism. Okay, now, since 2016, I've been saying all these things over and over and over again. But then when you talk about fascism going around the world for so many times, you face two problems. First problem is that people have a hard time recognizing fascism because it doesn't wear military boots and a funny mustache. Also, we are not used to seeing female leaders as the leaders of these movements, or we are not used to seeing these hilarious guys leading all the masses. Also, people want to see, you know, military costumes and so on. But then that was the Second World War period drama costume. Since then, artistic direction of fascism has developed a lot, actually. In 21st century, fascism comes as a form of entertainment, an absurdity, and with a lot of jokes. The second problem when you talk about fascism too much is that people get depressed. If you convince them enough, they begin asking you the question, so where is hope? There's something wrong with the word hope. It is too fragile for our times. And also, it makes me ask another question. What if there is no hope? Or a better question, what if there is hope? What will you do differently tomorrow? To be honest, I don't think it is hope that drives us as humans. It is our faith. I'm not talking about religious faith. I'm talking about faith in humans, in politics, and in ourselves. Our faith in politics, in humans, and in ourselves have shaken dramatically in the last few decades. So much so that we have a young generation who are asking themselves whether the human race deserves to exist at all. You know what? I think we have been living in the system for far too long. So the system has been telling us that we humans, are self-centered, selfish bastards. I think we forgot that we are not that. Not only that, at least. We do not survive difficult times by turning into monsters like Hollywood dystopian movies tell. As we've seen during the pandemic, we actually help each other. We actually create beauty in order to survive difficult times. We try to remind each other and ourselves that we are beautiful beings. You did it during the pandemic. You created beauty, artistic beauty, political beauty, moral beauty, to survive and to be in solidarity. So why am I talking about beauty? All of a sudden I was talking about fascism a minute ago. Because losing a country is not only about politics. What happens in the political realm, the loss of morality trickles down to people in our daily lives. Fascism comes for our most intimate relations. The people in those countries who have been through the process would understand what I mean. Fear rots people. The oppression rots people. Fascism does not stay in parliament or presidential palace. It leaks to people, to our friendships, to marriages, to love relationships. After a while, in fact, it changes your perception of humans. And you start thinking, maybe we humans are cheap people, cheap species. Maybe my people isn't worthy of caring. My point is, fascism in the end gets to your heart. And that is what we are supposed to protect today. Our hearts, our fundamental values. What was it that we wanted before all this political insanity stormed in? What were we asking for? We have to remember, because fascism makes people forget what they were and what they are capable today. That's why in the beginning of this speech, I told, take it personally. Because if enough time passes, it becomes personal. Fascism finds you wherever you're hiding. More than anyone, I tell this to women. They are the canaries in the mine. They feel the lack of oxygen, the first steps of losing a country, far before the men do. If women are alarmed about the state of a country, leave them, so that you don't lose your country, so that you don't lose faith in yourself in the end.
Listen to them, because this time we do not have the luxury of acting like a rock star. This time we cannot be fashionably late. This time, this political disaster might be the last one. So those people that should do something might be us. Thank you for listening.